and I've been in this place a few times. I remember in the old times, we started the CME credits and the conferences, and I used to do mostly all the speaking conferences. Now I was invited last year to talk about parathyroid, and this time to talk about the thyroid disorders. When I look at the flyer, I was impressed what I had to do. They say, thyroid disorders. Number one, hypothyroidism. Number two, hyperthyroidism. Number three, thyroid nodules. If you want me to do all of that, I would be happy to do it, but you have to invite me more than once. What I do is, I'm going to concentrate on the hypothyroid conditions, and inside that, I'll give you some guidelines about the hyperthyroid. I will talk about the thyroid nodules. And one thing that is coming really calling my attention is, I've been having a lot of consultations for thyroid storm. It's 0.3 per 100,000 cases of thyroid storm that you can see. And I'll be happy to see 2-3 thyroid storms in my lifetime. But all the time they call me to see patients for thyroid storm, then I have to rush myself to the place to see how the patient is storming. It's not thyroid storm, I tell the doctor, but they counsel me. But that's not the point of this call. It's to let you know that sometimes we might misdiagnose the patients with a problem that they don't have. Now, I don't have anything to disclose rather than I work for a living. I have my office practice and that's it. And I come to East Jefferson to see patients. When I have consultation, that's what I do. Now, what we're going to do is, we're going to talk about thyroid problems in general. The hypothalamic pituitary problems is less than 1%. Primary thyroid problems are greater than 99%. Autoimmune disorders, 80%. Non-autoimmune disorders, 20%. Hashimoto's thyroiditis, Graves' disease, hypothyroid and hyperthyroidism. Non-autoimmune, 20% is Goyer's, acute thyroiditis, thyroid nodules, and thyroid cancer. Then the Hashimoto's thyroiditis is the most common cause for hypothyroid. Now, if you have any questions at any given time, please stop me. If you don't understand what I say, ask me again. The thyroid problems, again, autoimmune is 80%, Hashimoto's thyroiditis, Graves' disease, and the Goiter. This is the history of the TSH-34 relationships. In here, you have the TSH levels. In this left side, you have the 3T4. The 3T4 standard is 0.7 to 1.8 nanograms per DL. There are many ways to check the 3T4. Then you have to be careful when you order your test to be sure that it's done for equilibrium dialysis. That the best way to do it, you have the IRMA analysis, but that's sometimes you can get confused with that. You don't want to do tests that is calculated. They have to be testing the hormone that you are looking for. Nowadays, we go to the 3T4. The only time that you don't need to use the 3T4 is during pregnancy. In pregnancy, you use the total T4 and the TSH. Now, you see here is greater than 100% is all of this is during the normal range here, 3T4 reference intervals. When it's undetectable, it's hypothyroid. When it's too much, it's hyperthyroid. Then you know the TSH decreases. And here the TSH increases. Now, at this situation, you have many patients that indeed, one of my colleagues yesterday asked me a question. He showed me a picture. They said, what do I do here? This patient TSH is 10.2. That was happening yesterday evening. And the T4 is, the free T4 is 1.38. Huh? Well, that patient was on amiodarone. We're going to talk about that in the head time, what the amiodarone does to the thyroid. That, my advice to him was this patient has type 2 or grade 2 hyperthyroid condition due by the amiodarone. Any questions about this? Everybody knows that. Yeah. Now, the hypothalamus pituitary axis, negative feedback, come from the thyroid gland with the T4 and T3. The T3 is more powerful than the T4, so the T4 is converted to T3 on the kidneys and the liver and the muscles. They go to the hypothalamus, produce TRH. I remember when I used to do all those investigations. And they go to the anterior pituitary that produces the TSH. The TSH comes down to the thyroid gland to stimulate the production of T4 and T3. Then you can have different disorders for the thyroid gland, being from the hypothalamus, being from the anterior pituitary, or being from the thyroid gland. Usually when it's related to the target organ, this time the thyroid gland is called primary disease. When it's related to the anterior pituitary gland, it's called secondary disease. And when it's related to the hypothalamus, it's called tertiary disease. Primary hyperthyroidism, what happens is the T4 increases, then the T3 increases, goes to the anterior pituitary, blocks the production of TSH, and that's defined as a primary hyperthyroidism. No TSH, high T4, or high T3. Now, there are different levels of hyperthyroidism. Could be T4 toxicosis or T3 toxicosis. And the treatments could be the same, but usually they are a little different. I don't believe that we are going to talk about that today, but let's see if we have time for that. Now, central hypothyroidism, tumors, Sheehan syndrome, lab error. Tumors in the pituitary gland could be prolactinomas, ESA tumors, could be sarcoidosis, that's one of the most common tumors, could be tuberculosis, any kind of pituitary tumor, or could be metastasis from the lymphomas, could be bone metastasis coming to there. Sheehan syndrome, that's what happens to the female when they have a baby and they start bleeding to death. The pituitary gland in the pregnancy is enlarged, and when the person starts bleeding, it goes into necrosis of the pituitary gland, which is what we call Sheehan syndrome. Sheehan syndrome is an association of hypopituitarism, including the hypothyroid disorder that is secondary. That's related to the central hypothyroidism. If this higher than that is called from the hypothalamus. I have one of my patients that been followed for probably 30 years. When this patient came to see me, she has a craniopharyngeal that was removed, and the doctor referred her to my office because she was 26 years old and she was still growing. Then what I found out is the patient has no pituitary hormones, and she continues to be like an infantile child. I have to start treating her to develop her vagina, develop her uterus, and develop her breast. Then, even she's up there, she has a central chunk, she's still alive, and she's doing well. Now, the hypothalamus pituitary thyroid axis, you have the TRH from the hypothalamus, you have the TSH, and you have the T4 and T3. The T3 is converted in the liver as well, and I told you on the kidney. And that's why you have the three disorders: tertiary disorder, secondary disorder, and primary disorder. There are target cells for the T4 and T3 throughout all the body. It's no need to, as you're going to find out, it's no need to do any kind of treatment with T3 for the patient because the T4 is converted to T3, except in few cases that the receptors, they don't react to the T3, then you have to give that medication to the patient. Thyroid function testing. T4, T3 levels alone might be misleading if TSH is not done. Always do the TSH first. The TSH has to be the primary test to be done. T4 also could be misleading protein binding alteration in pregnancy, proteinuria, or birth control pills, hepatic disease, or steroid therapy. That's it. The free T4 is non-thyroid illness, sick euthyroid state, failure to identify subclinical thyroid disease. Believe me or not, this is one of the most common consultations in the hospital for the patient with the abnormal T3 or abnormal T4 when they're in acute illness. Never treat the patient with thyroid medication until you prove that the patient is hypothyroid or hyperthyroid. Because what you are seeing on that sick patient is the reflection of the changes in the metabolism of the T4 and T3. Then you better believe it, you have to repeat the test. You send the sample to the lab, and then what the lab said here, we already done this test. Do you want to do it again? I mean, I know they want to say the money there, but sometimes you have to repeat the TSH, the T4, and the T3 to see the patient could be hyperthyroid, hypothyroid, or have what we call euthyroid-6 syndrome. That's the most common one. Now, when you measure TSH, sometimes you need to do T4 and T3 to be sure that this TSH correlates with this. If you have a central hypothyroidism, 5%, your TSH practically doesn't exist. And soon after therapy of hyperthyroidism, also this TSH could be different. Therefore, you cannot use TSH like many people do to follow the hyperthyroidism. And on non-thyroid illness, you have to have T4, T3, and the reverse T3. This is the TSH in milliliter international units per liter. When it's over 100, obviously the patient is hypothyroid. This is the normal subclinical hypothyroidism. This is the normal range around between 0.1 to 5 or 1 to 4.5, depending on the aging process of the human being. And this is becoming the subclinical hyperthyroidism, and over the spot, this patient becomes practically hyperthyroid. In the central hypothalamic pituitary disease, the levels could be normal, perhaps abnormal. TSH testing. If the TSH is normal, you don't need to do anything. Now, we do not recommend it to do a screening test for TSH. You don't do a TSH screen like you do hemoglobin A1C and stuff like that because it's not cost effective and you need to see the patient first. If you believe the patient has some kind of thyroid problem, you do the TSH. We see all these patients coming to the office, but the doctor did a $2,000 panel, and then they include the TSH. When they receive the test, they don't know what to do with that. Then it's better not to do it if we don't know what we're going to do with the test. In medicine, we try to do the test that we are going to do in benefit of the patient or to confirm the diagnosis of the patient. We don't tell the test that to tell us what the patient has. We need to know first what's going on with that crime or with that patient. Now, if the TSH is decreased, you do free T4. If the free T4 is normal, you might think about T3 toxicosis or subclinical hyperthyroidism. If the free T4 is low, then you have a case of central hypothyroidism or severe illness. Maybe this is where then you realize the patient could be hyperthyroid or could be just the severe illness that I was talking to you before. Now, if the free T4 is elevated, then it's easy. You say decreased TSH, high free T4, hyperthyroidism. Now, when you come to the right side, you see the TSH is elevated. You do the free T4. The free T4 is low, but hypothyroid. The free T4 is normal, subclinical hypothyroidism. TSH is free T4 is elevated, TSH is pituitary tumor. I don't believe you see too many of those cases, probably one case here and there, but it's probably in the literature, there are close to 30 or 40 cases of pituitary tumors producing TSH. Any questions about this? Okay. Again, to reemphasize, normal TSH, no further investigation. This assumes that pituitary functions are normal. Only you need to screen it when you believe that the patient might have thyroid conditions. Don't just put it on the doctor's order or the lab or the TSH, because that's becoming a little expensive, close to $120. Now, when the TSH is elevated, free T4 is low, it's hypothyroid. Normal, subclinical, we are going to talk about that. Elevated TSH in the tumor. Here is when it's decreased, free T4, low, central hypothyroidism or severe illness. Normal, T3 toxicosis, also clinical hypothyroidism. Always, when you see this picture here, check the T3. you can do the T3 total or the T4. And then that condition has to be treated because then the patient can go into atrial fibrillation. And we don't want that to happen. Now, when it's elevated, as you know, you have a hyperthyroid patient. Now, this is the development and progression of mild subclinical hypothyroidism. Years in life, from when you are born to the time you die. The youngest patient that had been hypothyroid, the patient was 10 days old. I'm still seeing the patient now. For 10 days, the pediatrician, the neonatologist was really smart to figure out that the patient was hypothyroid. And the patient has been treated now close to 16 years of age and 16 or 18. Then euthyroid means all the levels, TSH, T3, T4 are inside the normal range. Then becomes subclinical. The TSH starts increasing first, around 5 to 7. The T4 and T3 start declining, but still inside the normal range. Do not treat subclinical conditions. You see all the obese patients coming to your office, and they are going to tell you, "Doc, my thyroid is not working. My metabolism is low. My calories are not good. I need my thyroid medicine." Indeed, one of the patients sent me an email because on the electronic record they can do that. Said, "I need my desiccated thyroid." I said, "Desiccated thyroid? Why do you need that for?" "Yeah, because I need my thyroid. I'm tired." I said, "Your thyroid function is completely normal. If you give medications to the patient, mostly you get desiccated thyroid. The desiccated thyroid has T3, T4, T2, T1. That's all the byproducts of the thyroid gland. You are going to make these patients to go into atrial fibrillation and to have all these complications. That sooner or later you're going to pay for that." Then that's what there's a clinical, you follow the patient every 6 months. Or if the patients are having symptoms or signs that could be hypothyroid, then you go ahead and repeat the test, T3, T4, and TSH. I would recommend you to send the samples of the patients always to the same place. Don't send it to one lab today, to the other one tomorrow, because all of these labs have different references, and the technique they use is different. Always be consistent with one lab. Whatever you use, but use the same one all the time. And when the TSH goes high, this is probably 10 or higher than that, then, and the T3 and T4 go down, now you have a classical case of hypothyroidism. This is the chemical manifestation of the hypothyroidism. I'm pretty sure I don't have to tell you about the signs or symptoms of the patient being hypothyroid, because you know all of that. I don't have to tell you that. But here's causes of hypothyroidism. Hashimoto's thyroiditis. It's the number one cause of autoimmune disorders that produces the hypothyroidism. Yes, you do the thyroperoxidase antibodies and the thyroglobulin antibodies. You can tell the patient you have Hashimoto's thyroiditis and you're going to be hypothyroid, or you're going to be hyperthyroid, or you're going to be normal. If the patient has thyroperoxidase antibodies positive and thyroglobulin antibodies positive, you tell the patient you will be hypothyroid. But that's the manifestation of the thyroid in this patient. If the patient has normal thyroglobulin antibodies and normal peroxidase antibodies, that patient goes back to normal. Iodine deficiency is in Michigan, United States, and other parts of the world. And it produces the hypothyroidism, incidence reduced iodine salts usage. In the United States, the healthcare, all the blue labeled salt that you use at home has iodine. All the red labeled salt is iodine free. And you need to know that to tell the patient, you're preparing the patient for some kind of special test for the thyroid gland. Vitamins. You have all these kind of vitamins you can buy that they are loaded with iodine. And then the patient starts having goiters. Or you do the test for the Kyle Uptake and Scan, and it's practically negative because you don't know the history of the patient, what they are taking, and then you tell the patient, guess what, you are hypothyroid, you didn't take the iodine. What you do it is, before you do all these tests, you ask the patient to explain it to you, to tell you all the chemicals that they are using, over-the-counter herbs, vitamins, and to bring it to you, and then you check to be sure they have no curve or they have no iodine. Usually all these NCCND products that you buy, they have iodine. Now, I have a patient, I told you already that they had no thyroid gland, and she was hypothyroid. Or they had an enzyme defect of the thyroid gland. The cascade of the production of the thyroid T4 and T3, they had to go through different iodination products. And if you have three or four different defects there, and you have defect on the receptors, then those patients are going to be hypothyroid because they don't take up the T4 or T3. Now, if you remove the gland, or you treat the patient with the iodine, quantity one to treat the hyperthyroidism, then obviously you have to explain to the patient they're going to become hypothyroid. When the patient comes to the office, and you're going to send the patient to the surgeon, me as an endocrinologist, it's my duty to let the patient know what's going to happen. I have to tell the patient, few things could happen to you. Number one is that you're going to do fine, because you remove the tumor or you remove the gland, because you're hypertired. Number two is, the doctor is going to explain to you that he can damage the laryngeal nerve. Luckily, we don't see that here, because the surgeons mark the laryngeal nerves what they are doing. Number three is, you can become hypoparathyroid if they remove the parathyroid gland. I'm not going to do the surgeon of the patient, but it's my duty to explain to the patient that that's going to happen to them. And when they go to the surgeon, they can ask at the surgeon the same question, and they have to be sure that they understood what they get into. Now, you know that many people can have keloids on the neck or the part of the body. Then you can do the surgery through the axillary area with the kind of surgery that they become a robotic surgery. I saw how they do that. It's brutal. I don't want anybody to do that to me. They go through your axillary area. They start dissecting on your tissues. They get to the thyroid gland. And then they see the laryngeal nerve. They see all this. They start sucking the gland out. I mean, only, for me, the only time that I believe it could be that is if you have a keloid formation or you don't want to have a scar in your neck. But that's, if you have seen how they do that for the thyroid glands, I mean, you can do it for the prostate gland, for the uterus, which is just there. But is that doing the thyroid gland through the axillary area is like going to, if I want to go to Mandeville, I go to Mississippi. That, I believe that's every time I go to the hospital. Now, drug-induced, lithium and amiodarone. You know, the lithium is, I have a deposition for lithium, but it was not for the thyroid, it was for the sodium, hyponatremia. Yeah. But the amiodarone I need to talk about. Amiodarone is one of the medications that the cardiologists use to control the cardiac arrhythmias, and amiodarone is one of the best friends for the endocrinologist. It's good because they bring a lot of consultation in thyroid disorders. 100 milligrams of amiodarone has 3 milligrams of iodine. You give the patient 200 milligrams, you get 6 milligrams. The daily requirement for iodine is 0.3 milligrams. Then the amount of iodine you give to the patient on a daily basis is toxic for the thyroid gland. And the half-life of the amiodarone, even when you stop it, it's 100 days plus. Then you find that the patient has cardiac arrhythmia, whatever the doctor is trying to do to control the heart. And the amiodarone is the cause of thyroid problems. It's no need to stop it, because you have to wait for 100 days to see the benefits of discontinuing the amiodarone. Of course, you also know, like Dr. Natalie knows about the pulmonary changes or inflammation that the amiodarone causes. I had the two cases now in the hospital. One with the pulmonary disease because of amiodarone, and the other one with the cardiac hypothyroidism because of the amiodarone. Then, the amiodarone produces three different types of disorders on the thyroid gland. Direct hypothyroidism is because the iodine practically destroys the production of T4 and T3. And not only that, it can produce necrosis of the gland. Then the hypothyroidism, you treat it like you treat the regular hypothyroid patient. And the other one is the hyperthyroidism. The hyperthyroidism is two types. The type one is when the patient has a goiter, has nodule, or subclinical Graves' disease. Then those people, they become hyperthyroid. Then those kind of people, you can treat it with the Tapazole or PTU. The type two or the hyperthyroid patient that you see with the amiodarone, when they produce direct necrosis of the gland, giving like some type of thyroiditis, increase the T4, sometimes increase the TSH or decrease the TSH. Those patients you don't treat with metimazole or PTU, you treat with prednisone. And it's a temporary condition, needs 3 or 4 months to get better because that is the time that the amiodarone lasts in your body. And sometimes it remains permanent, meaning that you need continue treating the patient. On occasion, you have to do ablation of the thyroid gland or remove the thyroid gland. Now, the problem to do the ablation of the thyroid gland is that these people are taking 6 milligrams of iodine a day. Then the iodine 131 uptake is going to be practically suppressed, it's not going to be good. Then sometimes, only those people that are super hyperthyroid, the ablation will respond to them. Amiodarone is still used in the market. I'm not going to stop because it's good for the cardiology. But that's one of our business. Relation of hypothyroid symptoms and signs to age. When we are aging, the situation is different. The requirements are different. The treatment is different. This is greater than 70 years old and less than 55. This is the p-value for significant regional. Fatigue is the same, greater than 70 or less than 55. Mental slowness, the same. Cold sensitivity. If you are less than 55, you have more sensitivity to cold than if you are greater than 70 years of age. Then that's significantly different. Constipation is similar to both of them. Weight gain, if you are less than 55, you have a tendency to have more weight gain than you are greater than 70. Muscle cramps, exactly the same. Paresthesias, mostly in the extremities, also the same, 61%, 18%. Bradycardia is the same. Hypothyroidism gives you bradycardia, give you a lot of problem with the heart, can give you the pericardial effusion, can give you cardiomyopathy. But all of that you can read in the books. Then we do again low serum T4. Be aware of the protein and normal diseases. Pregnancy, proteinuria, kidney failure, hepatic disease. Low serum free T4. Fails to identify subclinical hypothyroidism and non-thyroidal illnesses. Low or normal serum T3, elevated serum TSH, except in central hypothyroidism. Then you realize that this appears to be an easy issue, but you have to start analyzing step by step where you are before you start treating the patient for the thyroid condition. How we treat the patient with hypothyroidism? The preparation of choice is L-thyroxine, T4. You had the patients coming to the office, Dr. Pedrosa, I want the brand name. Syntra, I don't want the L-thyroxine, I don't want the levothyroxine. Give me the brand name. I pay more money, but it's good for me. Guess what? They're right. There are too many generic levothyroxines that the absorption rate is completely different. Therefore, the biological activity in that patient's body is going to be different because they are absorbing different. The brand name Syntra, even though that is more expensive, the absorption rate is consistent and that the patient can continue taking the same amount. Now, the brand name might cost them $50 copay. People can afford that. But there are too many patients that say, I can't afford this. Okay, let's play with the level of thyroxine. But tell your pharmacy to give you only the same generic type levothyroxine and not to be changing every visit that you go there. And ask the pharmacy to give you the complete bottle, 100 pills. And that way you know it's going to last you 3 months. Then what I do is say, okay, you have to come back every 6 weeks because that is half life for me to check your TSH and T4 to see if you need more. Then little by little, you start increasing the generic medication until the patient reaches the normal levels. All of this is a serious problem with the endocrinologists now and the brand name medications because they are becoming expensive, and you send it to the pharmacy doesn't give the brand name, give the generic, and the patient goes back to you, doc, I feel sick. Say, what are you taking? I'm taking this pill. I didn't prescribe you that, but that's what they gave you. And that's what the insurance companies have to take. That's the preparation of choice. LT3 Cytomer. Cytomer has specific indications, mostly mixed edematoma. Anyone of you has seen a mixed edematoma? Probably not. Mixed edematoma is the terminal condition of the thyroid disease. This happens in people who are aging, they start feeling tired, they start feeling weak, the face starts getting like a renal face. The eyes are getting bloated, and finally end in the hospital in hypothermia. Yeah, the reflexes are practically non-existent. The skin is the yellow, the coloration of the skin because of the mixedema. One out of two of them die. It's difficult to save their lives. I mean, but if you want to do something, you have to start basing on steroids first. You give it solubortet, don't give it the thyroid, you start the steroid medication, IV. The one the patient is slowly with this, you start giving the levothyroxine. You can give it 100 micrograms or 200 micrograms IV. And then you can give the Cytomer IV 3-4 times a day. And luckily, this patient in ICU, with this kind of medication, you can bring it back to life. But 50% mortality, that's the ratio of the mixedema coma. That's one of the indications for the Cytomer. Now, when do you see the Cytomer that is used? When they come from the street? All these people who do weight control, they give Cytomer to the patient. I have one patient coming, 150 micrograms of Cytomer, has no hair. And the patient was practically, said, you cannot take this medicine. This is killing you. He said, you are not my doctor, but I said, okay, good. Go back to your doctor and give the Cytomer. But that's one of the indications for Cytomer. What is the other indication for Cytomer? When the target tissue, they can convert T4 to T3 or the deiodination process is impaired. Then those patients, they need the Cytomer. You measure the T3 and then you follow the T3. And those patients are going to respond better. Now, you see here T4 and T3. Many patients like to do that. But it's no need to do that because the T4 in patient hypothyroid goes into T3. And this is the one that I told you before, they called me about. Desiccated thyroid, armor thyroid, the vaccine. That's obsolete. But regardless what I said, the patient goes to your office because they want the armor thyroid. They want this kind of medication because they say it works better than the other one. And sometimes you have to believe the patient. But not many endocrinologists like to prescribe this around the country. They just want to prescribe or maintain the L-thyroxine and Cytomer. Okay. After the tablet dissolution in the stomach, the absorption is 50 to 80% along the entire back, small bowel. The half-life is 7 days. The T4 is converted to T3 in peripheral tissues, just like endogenous T4. They go through the same process of metabolism. Now, how much it is? The normal dosing, the production ratio is 80 to 100 micrograms per day. Given the normal absorption, that is 80%, The requirement is 100 to 125. But 50% that predictable, the hormone requirement increases to 160 to 200. Believe it or not, I have patients like weigh 300 pounds that they are true hypothyroid and they need around 300 to 400 micrograms of syndrome. But the normal person, this is a high dose. The normal dose is around maximum 150. Now, if you want to do calculations, you do this, 0.8 micrograms per pound per day, or 1.6, 1.8 micrograms per day, depending on the patient body weight. Now, the complication of giving too much thyroid is, you send a patient to a cardiologist on atrial fibrillation, then the patient might have a stroke, so the patient doesn't want to start the medicine. You need to give the thyroid medication only once a day. We usually tell the patient to take it early in the morning on an empty stomach. But many patients talk, I work at night, okay. Take at least on an empty stomach at night. Just wait 2 to 3 hours after the last meal and you can take your thyroid medication, but be consistent. Don't take it today in the morning and tomorrow in the evening. Stick to one time of the day, morning or evening. Time of the day can be adjusted to improve compliance, including a bedtime. You have to be 30 minutes before eating. Cabbage, cauliflower, onion decreases the absorption. Calcium, all these products do the same. Now, if you miss one dose, you can take 2 doses the next day. But don't tell me that you're going to take all your medication at the end of the week, because that's not good. Not because I missed 3 doses, I'm going to take a Saturday. I don't have to worry about Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday. Now, of course, the medication is depending on the etiology of the hypothyroidism and severity. Age and pregnancy. During the pregnancy, as soon as the female called me that she's pregnant and she's hypothyroid, number one, I said, congratulations. Number two is, increase the dose by 30%. Immediately. Why I tell the patient that? Because the major complications during pregnancy happens in the first 6 weeks of pregnancy. All the brain malformations, congenital malformations, all of this is during the first 6 weeks of the embryo. Then you have to be really careful. Like all these people that come to the office with in vitro fertilization, that treat for hypothyroid, as soon as they get pregnant, they'll be there. Now, the other problem is this. I had the females tell me, doc, I cannot get pregnant. So I'm going to find a way for you to get pregnant. Then I have a lady that she was, when she came to me, she was like 100 pounds. But she was hypothyroid. She said, you know what? I go through all these doctors. No one can tell me why I cannot get pregnant. So, okay, let's do the conditions. 6 weeks later, she comes back. She said, doc, you know what? I'm pregnant. Now she has a beautiful baby and she weighs 120 pounds. When you have a problem with fertility and the patient cannot get pregnant, start talking about the females, check the TSH. But guess what? In this case, it's different. The TSH could be normal. Then you check the T4 and T3. They could be normal. But you treat these people to prepare them for pregnancy with low doses of Synthroid, levothyroxine, then if that's the condition, they can get pregnant. I work with the fertility doctors and I do first the preparation with the thyroid and I send it to them and then they do the in vitro fertilization or whatever they have to do to be sure the patient can keep the conceptus. Bioavailability is 50 to 80%. Okay, when your patient is more than 60 years of age, don't be too aggressive. To start the patient in the same amount of Synthroid or levothyroxine that you do for the younger patients. You can use the lower doses between 25 to 50 micrograms and increase slowly every month until you reach the TSH level that you expected in the patient. I usually don't treat any patient with TSH greater than 5 to 10 if the patient is more than 60 years of age. The reason being is because those patients have tendency to have more complications from the cardiovascular system point of view. What you do, you just follow the patient. And when you see the cascade that the TSH continues to increase and finally the T4 and T3 start coming down, that's the time to treat the patient. Usually when the TSH goes about 12.5 or 15. Don't get scared if the TSH is 10 and start giving medication to the patient because you don't make any benefit for that patient. That's what I'm telling you about this. Aging process bring the endocrinology of aging is completely different to the endocrinology of the youth. This completely different metabolism. They are really slow metabolic activities. And you can create more problems and less benefits giving all this medication. The same happens with the cortisol or other hormones that we use. Age plays a very important role, that's what I'm telling you. Faster people clearance in children. Children usually need more thyroid medication than the people above 25. You have to increase the dose. We have a pediatric endocrinologist that they know what they are doing with that. Sometimes, if they cannot see a pediatric endocrinologist, you have to be ready to treat those kids. One of the manifestations of the kids with hypothyroidism is right knee problems. Problem with the right knee. When I'm at the office, I see the child walking and I look how he walks. Then I can tell the mother, you know, he's hypothyroid. How do you know that? I'm looking at him. Then you start treating that patient. Now, when you start getting older, like everything else in life, the clearance is less and the dosage required is almost 25% lower than the adult. Now, we're talking about pregnancy. I already told you that, increased by 30%. As soon as you know the patient is pregnant, you have to start doing that. If you cannot deal with this problem, don't see the patient. Because then the benefit for you is somebody is coming to knock on your door. We usually do this, the lawyers. If the baby has a malformation of the brain, they calculated the half-life of that baby, 75 years of age. That's the way they are going to see you. They don't sue you because you failed to do this. They are going to sue you because you failed to make this child to be alive and healthy. Therefore, be careful with that. Not many endocrinologists want to treat females during pregnancy for the hyperthyroid, for the thyroid, or for diabetes. I don't have a problem doing that. I have a lady who has in any stage renal disease. She has twins. I saw her once a week, and the twins were nice. The nephrologist told her, you have to have an abortion. She said, you're crazy. I don't go back to see you. But the nephrologist was right because she was on dialysis. Okay. This is the way it goes with the age. Less than 40 is around 180 amount of medication. 40 to 60 is around 140. More than 60 is around 120. Think about it. This is what you need to know about the thyroid replacement therapy. Don't try to use like, your TSH is 10, let me give you 200. Because that's not going to be your friend. The thyroxine dosage is 0.5 to 2.5, that's the normal levels. Sometimes people don't want to bring it down to 0.5, just keep it around 1 or 1.5. Now, when you are in the 60s or 70s, you like to keep it around 3 to 3.5 to be sure that the patient is going to do fine. So you have to increase the T3 and TSH levels during the normal range. Of course, you can use the lean body mass to see how much these patients need, because the patient is very obese, so you need more medication. Now, how do you do this? The clinical status, you have to check with the patient. You have to physically examine the patient to make sure the patient is doing fine. Then you follow the TSH. This is the numbers. The TSH can lag 1 to 2 weeks before the pre-T4 level, meaning that the T4 can become normal first and the TSH become normal later. It takes 6 weeks to fully equilibrate. That's why I tell the patients, you see me today, in 6 weeks from today, on fasting condition, between 7 and 8 a.m., you do the blood work. Always say to the patient, between 7 and 8 a.m. That's endocrinology. At that type of the morning is when we have the highest levels of hormones, even if you are treating the patient. Then, you cannot use TSH to check the patient with pituitary problems or hypothalamic problems because the TSH doesn't exist. Then you have to use T4 or T3. TSH targeting elderly, 4 to 6 mL per liter. You see what I'm telling you? You have to be really careful with the elderly patient. You cannot give too much medication. Just try to keep the TSA between 4 to 6. You are not doing any damage. You are doing benefit for the patient. This is the TSA normal range, 0.5 to 5. And they ought to be 0.5 to 2.5 in the younger people. Now, greater than 5 mL, if you are treating the patient, you can increase by 25 micrograms and repeat TSH in 6 to 8 weeks. 0.5 to 5, just be happy, continue the same. Go back to 6 months or annually, if that's what you want to do. Less than 0.5, you decrease the L-thyroxine by 12.5 to micrograms, and you repeat again 6 to 8 weeks later. Okay. Circumstances associated with altered L-thyroxine requirement. Those decrease, TSH is low. Greater than 7 to 8 years of age. Weight loss. Changes in concomitant medications. Use of androgens. Nowadays, we have a problem with the androgens because all the men want to have androgens. I saw a guy, I'm afraid, he came to see in front of me and said, I need my cream. I said, what kind of cream do you need? My androgen cream. I said, okay, let me look at your blood. I said, man, you don't need androgen cream. Your testosterone is 578 with normal testosterone-binding hormone. If you want me to give you androgen cream because I want to send you to the hospital with cardiomyopathy, pulmonary fibrosis, what do you want? No, I don't want androgen cream. Okay, good, bye. You're healthy. Okay, but that's common, okay? This is one of my practice, giving androgens to the patient to treat them when they need it. But this is the condition that you have to be careful with the TSH low. Now, TSH is high. Pregnancy, we know, is estrogens. That you have to be really careful with the TSH, not to be too aggressive, but you have to bring it inside the normal range, around between the first trimester, you keep the TSH between 1 to 3. On the second trimester, you can keep it around 2.5 to 3. And after the third trimester, you can keep around 3.5. You need to know the female, the pregnant female is a complete different endocrine case. During the pregnancy, they belong to a different system. Malabsorption, that decreases T4, calcium, iron. If the patient is on iron or calcium, please be sure to let them know that the hospital here, when they are giving iron to the patients, do not use iron and thyroid replacement therapy at the same time. The pharmacists know that. Now, there are medications that reduce T4 to T3. I told you already, we talk about Amiodarone, my best friend. Amiodarone decreases the conversion of T4 to T3 and bring more patients to endocrinology. Effect, okay, all these medications are going to increase block the absorption of the T4, calcium, iron, salt, cholestyramine, cholesterol, aluminum hydroxide, sucrose, PPI. Speed up the metabolism, anti-convulsion, rifampin, sertraline. Increased thyroid-binding globulins, estrogen, methadone, fibrolacia. Decreased thyroid-binding globulins, androgens. This is very important, the androgens. And again, amiodarone is here. Then the major evil that we have is the estrogens, the androgens, and the amiodarone. The reason for the estrogen and the androgen is because the transgender patients, they can buy hormones over the counter. All my transgender patients said, don't go back to your hormones, they come to my office, I see you, I write your prescription. Because, I mean, all these females who want to make males, males going to be females, they are medical cases and you treat them like a human being. But many doctors, they don't want to do that. Then these people end up on the street buying all these medications that they don't need to buy. Here we go with subclinical hypothyroidism. Normal T4, pre-T4, or pre-thyroxinemia. Normal T3, high TSH, less than 5, usually close to 10. Plus anti-thyroid antibodies in 60 to 75% of cases. And I tell you this, every patient that has a thyroid antibodies positive, they are going to become hypothyroid. Okay. What happens to during the time that we are aging? When you are 18, woman is this color, men are the color of this, less than 5% is could be hypothyroid, start increasing to 5% around 25. 35 the females are picking up, and then from here up, all the females, sometimes 30 to 40% of the females become hypothyroid. You have to pay attention to the geriatric population and the thyroid gland disease. This is a normal manifestation, the cow displays it with the curve. And you realize they start displacing there, and here in the 80s, just start moving more and more, and then you have more people with a hypothyroid condition, with TSH levels around 7.1. But never complete. You have to wait that you go through the 10, 16, 24. And that's at the consultation that I had. You see, they say that the patient TSH is 56. They come in because the patient is mixed. Mix the macoma. That's not mixed the macoma. When you are 80 years old, that's normal for you. You're, no, it's not normal, but you don't mean I have to treat the patient that way. Okay. The prevalence of subclinical hypothyroidism is depending on the upper limits of normals for serum TSH. The TSH gives you the what the patient is hot, subclinical, or not. Okay, this is another study that published in the Journal of Clinical Endocrinology. Again, 45, TSH, 55. It tells you exactly the same. The older you are, the more chances you have to be hypothyroid. This is another study done in the same journal. You see it? And this is this guy. Did these studies and showed that greater than 80 years old, he didn't see too many hypothyroid. I don't know what kind of study anyway. And this is the aging process of the thyroid, normal, mild thyroid failure, over hypothyroidism. That, just to remind you that if you remember this, I'll be happy with the conference. This euthyroid, mild hypothyroid, over hypothyroidism, that's the situation. Okay. So treat or not to treat? Improving mild symptoms, no weight loss. No usable weight loss. Lipid profile. Lipid profile only if the TSH is more than 10. We didn't talk about that because the lipids are really involved in the hypothyroid condition. Or to prevent over hypothyroidism. Those ones that had a positive thyroid peroxidase antibody. Potential drawbacks, improved symptoms, lipids unusual with TSA between 5 and 10. Meaning that if you have a TSA less than 10, don't treat the cholesterol with the levothyroxine. Or you can overtreat the patient. And these are all expenses, the lifetime of this patient. And many patients, 50% reverse to the normal thyroid function. And this is the contemporary management of subclinical hypothyroid, elevated TSAs, to have 3T4, TPO, lipids, TSA less than 10, TSA greater than 10, treat with T4, negative antibodies, elderly, pregnancy, or desire to be pregnant, we already talked about this. Then TSA less than 10, which is considered LT4 if it is positive. Goiters, increased lipid, depression, you don't treat depression with the thyroid anyway. Middle age, pregnancy, the desire to be pregnant. I want to talk about that. Thank you. Now, I know that you want me to talk about thyroid nodules, hyperthyroid conditions. If you have any questions about any issues in reference to the thyroid, let me know. Otherwise, I'm leaving. No questions? Either. I said, so, thank you so good. Nobody understood what I said.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you.